start with the chimney committee. Anyone got any interest? No. The minutes, pre-minutes, last one.
Agree.
Okay, no one is going wrong with being filmed on your order? No, okay. Item three then.
Thank you, Chair. As indicated in the training, there are changes to come into effect on the 1st of October, which will mean that we are moving from issuing licences to hackney carriage and private hire drivers on an annual basis to a three-year basis. Bearing that in mind, members are asked to consider amendments to the requirements that drivers must meet before they are granted the license, before the license is actually renewed. Set out in the report are the current requirements that must be met before an individual may be granted an hackney carriage or private hire driver license, which are the VRQ, which is the qualification required, and the knowledge test, satisfactory driving license, satisfactory enhanced certificate from the disclosure of RX service, and a satisfactory medical. As you are aware, as stated previously, the deregulation act got word sent in March of this year and comes into effect in relation to private hire and hackney carriage driver licenses on the 1st of October. And from that date, we will be looking to issuing licences for 3 years and renewing licences for a three-year period. And the requirement for a licence to be renewed are for a satisfactory driving licence, a satisfactory enhanced certificate from the disclosure and barring service, and currently a satisfactory medical on an annual basis from 65. Members will be aware that in March of this year, this committee resolved to amend the current medical requirement so that medical checks are to be undertaken on initial application and thereafter every 3 years, with checks being undertaken annually from the age of 65. And there was further resolved on the 2nd of June this year that this policy to come into effect from the 1st of October to be in line with the introduction of licences being issued on a three-year basis. Members are asked to consider bringing the other requirements for the renewal of hackney carriage and private hire driver licences in line with the three-year licences, so that the requirement in order for us to grant the renewal, that there is a satisfactory enhanced disclosure and barring certificate issued no more than 28 days prior to the renewal date, a satisfactory medical report in accordance with the Council's policy for medicals, and we would ask that that medical is also presented within 28 days of the renewal period, a satisfactory driving record. Members may be aware that the driver and vehicle licensing agency no longer issue paper counterparts to driving licenses, and drivers are now required to provide a code to licensing officers in order that access may be made to their current driving record. That appears to be working well at the moment, and it gives us instant access to a driver's record. And if they don't come equipped with the code, then they are accessing the code while they're actually in the office, and that seems to be working quite well. Okay, it is proposed that drivers who are currently licensed and become due for renewal from the 1st of October provide evidence of the above requirements before the license is renewed, and thereafter, before each three-year renewal. I'll go through, in summary, what the recommendation is. The principle being that before we issue a renewal, as I referred to in the training, that we are satisfied as a council that that individual is fit and proper person to hold a licence for a period of 3 years. Bearing in mind that, as I say, we may not have any further contact in respect to that person's driver licence for another 3 years. And it's important that we receive all the documentation to assess that criteria at the application stage. Currently, when drivers are licensed and they may have had a license for a number of years, every 3 years they are asked to produce a disclosure and barring certificate. But they are used to possibly having their license renewed and then we wait for that disclosure barring certificate to come back. And if anything is shown on that, then we refer them to the licensing panel if it's appropriate to do so. What we're seeking is a clear line whereby they come to their appointment for their renewal equipped with their certificate that they receive from the disclosure and barring service, their medical, and their code in order that we may access their driving record. And in reference to the disclosure and barring certificate and their medical report, we are asking that that has been issued within 28 days of the renewal date. Okay. Would it help if I run through what I put in the report? Because we are going to have to spell this out very clearly to drivers. And we will spend time with drivers in particular who are due for renewal October, November, December. And we've got measures in place whereby we will be writing to them and we will be engaging with them to ensure that they don't come to an appointment with their application form for the DBS certificate. We don't want that. We want the certificate itself, which can take a number of weeks to be issued after they've made the application to the disclosure and barring service. So we have put in the report, for the avoidance of doubt, if members were to approve the recommendation, an application will not be considered unless the above requirements are met on or before the renewal date. And the granting of the renewal will be subject to whether the details provided through the documentation satisfy the requirements of the Hackney Carriage and Private Hire Drivers Policy. So, for example, if somebody was to present on renewal a certificate from the disclosure and barring service that showed convictions that weren't there previously, and in accordance with our policy they needed to refer to the licensing panel, then that is what would happen. If it is obviously clear and satisfactory, then the license would be renewed.
Okay, and just further information for members. This has been discussed with the consultative committee. Councillor Niblock has attended a couple of operators' meetings, and that has been discussed there. We discussed it the other week with one of the trade unions. So, as we learned, it's no big surprise to people. No. Well, Councillor Niblock. And Councillor Sullivan, next questions.
Yeah, thank you. I'm just wondering how, given some of the members on this committee have been on the licensing panel for a number of years, given that we are moving 2 to 3 year licenses, how many times have we heard that we've only found out about a conviction, for example, for speeding or using a mobile phone by taxi drivers when they've come to renew? And the little niggle I've got is tell us until we come to review how we're going to manage this, if it does.
Thank you, that's answered, I'm taking that.
Yes, thank you, Chair. We have obviously given consideration to this because it is an observation that we share. What we will be doing is looking at every opportunity that we can in terms of our meetings with drivers, in that we don't only come across them when they come in for their driver licence. Obviously, we inspect their vehicles as well. So we will be looking to have officers trained so that they will automatically, whenever they have any meeting or, you know, where we call a vehicle in for inspection, when their vehicle as well, so if a driver comes in to renew their vehicle, then we will ask for the code and we will do a check on their driving record there. And we can also do random checks as well. So these will be procedures that we will need to look at and introduce before the 1st of October. I say currently we rely on the actual driver license process to look and keep monitoring the driving record. As you say, they, as part of our policy, and that's something again that I will be looking at and reviewing and we'll be bringing back later in the year, they do have to tell us when these things happen. We do find that they don't always do that. And so we will be looking at every opportunity that we can to use this process now through the DVLA, where we can ask them for a code and we can check there and then. They don't have to, you know, it's not a case of, well, I haven't got my counterpart with me, or I've sent it off to the DVLA. It's an instant check, is that right, Margaret? Yeah.
I understand things like speeding convictions, use of mobile phones, which seems to have dropped off drastically with taxi drivers. But and you've got parking on exactly on that issue. But that fine to check with the code and the DVLA. What about other criminal convictions?
We are encouraging, and I'm hearing officers all the time when people are coming in now to renew, we are encouraging drivers to sign up to the mandate, the disclosure of borrowing service, update service, where they pay an annual fee of £13. If they do sign up to the update service, then we can check at any time whether or not there has been a change to their criminal record. What it won't tell us is what that change is, but it will indicate that there's been a change. If we were to see a change, then we would ask them to come in and fill out an application and obtain the full certificate, when we would then see what that change was. We're currently going to operate that, if you like, on a voluntary basis, and it would be a matter for you as a committee as to whether or not in the future you want to consider making that a mandatory requirement. As I indicated before, what we can't do is put conditions on hackney carriage drivers, so it would have to be a policy decision and we'd seek advice from Ken in respect of that. But we, you know, I'm hearing, and there was a much lengthy debate that an officer, and she handled it excellently, with a driver who was, he was listening, but he was saying, you know, well, you're asking me to pay £44 now for my disclosure of borrowing certificate, and you have to sign up to the update service within, how many days is it, Margaret, from that?
19 days.
And when you get that certificate, you have to sign up to the update service and then pay £13, and then annually £13. So it's just it's a matter of how you see it in terms of logic. They tend to think that a disclosure of borrowing certificate lasts for 3 years. It doesn't have a life length. It's just that's the period of time that they're asked to have it checked. It's a check and it lasts for and is valid for that time that it's done. You know, somebody could go and commit an offence the next day. Similarly, when you get your car MOT'd, can be found that day, and then there can be a light bulb that goes out the following day. So we are mindful of that. And we do have other intelligence that does come our way, and we work very closely with our partners in Merseyside Police in that respect.
Okay. Mike.
Thanks, Chair. I think that voluntary system, just to come back on what Steve said, I think it should be mandatory for the protection of the public. My concern is, it's all well and good when we've got drivers coming in who've lived all their lives in this country. What about now we've got the free movement of labour in the EU, and we've also got immigration? What about people who come in from abroad? I know we've got reciprocal agreements with other licensing authorities throughout the world, but if we deem that they've got a driving test in that country, that their license in this country is okay to use. But what about people who come over, they could have a criminal record, they could have done something sexually, and they shouldn't really be driving around picking people, the general public up. How can we possibly, Margaret, how can we pick up on things like that? And the other thing, we could have, with the 3-year licences, with the worst case scenario, we could have somebody driving around the Wirral or Merseyside who hasn't even got a licence for 3 years.
There are processes whereby we do undertake checks. There is what's called a certificate of good conduct that would be obtained for somebody who'd not been living in this country for a period of time. And members themselves here actually refused a license to an individual who's actually lived all his life in this country, but had travelled abroad and worked abroad for a considerable number of years. And because they weren't satisfied that the criminal record check in this country could cover all the time that he wasn't in this country, they refused the license. So, you know, there are processes, and we do have strict processes in place. I mean, our whole purpose for being here is to protect the public, and ourselves as officers and you as members work to that on a daily basis. And I'm confident that we do everything that we can, and we always seek to improve and find better ways to protect the public at all times. And, you know, officers are very alert to sometimes incidents that don't fall within any of those categories. You know, sometimes there are issues that we can look at and think, you know, okay, they might not have committed an offence, or they might not have, but there is something there. So if there's any doubt in anyone's mind, they will refer it to Margaret or myself, and sometimes we have discussions with Ken. So if there's anything at all, you know, where we have any doubts. But, you know, we're not eyes and ears everywhere, and we would welcome, you know, if there are any concerns. But again, through what's been referred to earlier, through the meetings with operators as well, we work closely with the operators who give out this work to drivers, and they want to protect themselves. And only yesterday at our meeting, we were looking at ways in which they can support the concerns of child sexual exploitation that has been raised in people's awareness and minds, and we went through, you know, factors that they can look for, you know, when they're taking bookings or when their drivers are out there working. And they're all very supportive, and they all very much want their drivers to be part of that and to protect the public as well. And we did have one of our drivers who reported an incident of a young child, and actually found a young child who had actually gone missing. So, you know, I think we need to be mindful, whilst we're here discussing all those issues, that we've got a lot of good drivers out there, and, you know, a lot of work does go on, but we don't get to hear about, and unfortunately we will get to hear the complaints more than the compliments on drivers. So yes, but you are right, we need to be vigilant, and anything whereby we feel that there needs to be extra measures, we will bring them to you. Or if you want to raise anything, please let me know. We can discuss the legality of those.
Thanks, Chair. Just one other point, and I think it's been mentioned before many times. A dress code sometimes. You do see some, and you go to other countries, you know, and they do have dress codes, and it does make a big difference. So,
I mean, we do have a dress code. Obviously, what we don't have is 800 officers who are out there, sort of with every journey that they make. So we do rely on people reporting things, and I want you to have the confidence that if you do report things, we do act on it. So, you know, if you yourselves or people you know have a bad experience with either a driver or a vehicle, please tell us, because we will act on it and we will call that driver in, and we will make an assessment in terms of against the dress code and, you know, and how they turn up. And there's been an improvement over the years, certainly, I've noticed, as to how people turn up to the licensing panel. There's a message on out there that the way you dress does make a difference. And, you know, that there have been smarter dressed people appearing at the licensing panel. And that's a formal occasion for them. But I have seen, you know, years gone by where they didn't even have that respect for members, really.
Thanks, Chair. It's in relation to comments you've made about the applicants themselves bringing in the correct paperwork and the NC, whatever it is, that they require, plus the 13 family in check so that you can look back on it. Obviously, that will be a cost to the authority, that over and above what we're doing already. The second part of that question is, as quite often mentioned, that quite a few drivers appear and are quite close to the maximum amount of penalty points on the licence. If we give them a 3-year licence, they leave here. Just want to give a comment to that. Your MOT, you won't go over the next day. They could go over the next day. How do we know, or how are we told? The magistrates go to the penalty, or do we have to go looking to find that information? And if we do, how do we cover that cost?
Yes, Chair, I think in terms of costs and fees, I can go into those in a bit more detail onto the next item.
Yeah,
if that's okay. In terms of the checks, then, you know, I'm keen for us to do as many checks as we can, obviously with the resources that have. We will be reviewing, we're very mindful of the changes that this legislation brings to us, and therefore our checking and inspection regimes will be reviewed to take into account the fact that we are issuing licences for a longer period of time. And, you know, I'll certainly keep you updated, and if there are any cost implications from those, then they can be reflected in the fees that we charge. And as I say, I'll cover that maybe in a little bit more detail to the next item.
Sorry, how
do we know? We expect the drivers to tell us the next day. We've given a license for 3 years.
Sorry, Chair.
I was asking, how do we know? He tells us. Are we relying on the taxi driver?
Yes.
Yes, we are.
Chair.
I've got to agree with him. We have to rely on the taxi drivers to be honest and forthright with us. I mean, how many times have been before us, and I can not count on one hand, I'd need about 50 hands to turn around and turn and say, I didn't know that. I'm changing dresses. I've moved from this address to that address to that, and there's no follow. It's going to be hard for us to keep a check on it over a 3-year time scale, whereas before 12 months we could keep an eye on it. I'm not blaming myself, this is government led, and there's nothing we can do about it. It's going to be And that has been that change in addresses. Oh, I haven't moved from there, I've gone from there. And when you go back to me, I say, your taxi's, we know the taxi's sitting outside the house. So, you know, who's telling the truth? And it's hard for us, yeah, I've got to come back. The other thing is, I'll leave it for that, is it's on exactly the same thing of notification when they turn around and say to us, I didn't know, I had to notify you. And we tell them, yes, you do. You know it because you spoke to me, and they go, on. I haven't.
Yes, Chair. I think what's been illustrated and demonstrated are all the reasons why we have continued to issue licences on an annual basis for all those reasons. Whilst, you know, as it explained in the training, that we currently can issue licences for 3 years, and there are, you know, a lot of authorities that do currently issue licences for 3 years. So, you know, they are all those reasons, and we are, as I say, very mindful of that. So we will be monitoring it, and as indicated, the legislation, whilst it starts with the assumption that it's 3 years, it does give that provision that we can issue it for a lesser period if we consider it appropriate in the circumstances. So, you know, that is the type of information that I will be reporting back to you and providing you with updates as to how we are finding that particular process. And as said previously, you know, it's not all, you know, when you think of how many drivers that we actually license, that, you know, we are talking about a proportion of drivers here, not all drivers. So I think we do need to monitor it closely and see how effective the processes are. Again, mindful, protecting the public is our job. And, you know, we will, if I have any concerns at all, I will bring those concerns to you.
Okay, we'll take Jerry then. Back to Mike then, I'm going to move on.
Really a very quick question, Bill, about an education model, which I maybe should have answered. What is the disclosure of monitoring services? Is it a government service? Do they have to pay for it? Where do they get the information from?
Right, very good question. It was called, and most people remember, the CRB check.
It's the same as that.
It
just says the name.
Sorry, I didn't
know.
Should I know this? When did they change the name?
It's a couple of years now, isn't it?
Is it? Yeah. I should have done it.
So you're mayor and you say,
don't you record that?
No, in fairness, a lot of people still refer to it as CRB. So you probably would not notice that it's changed because people are still in that.
So you're saying that people that can pay a subscription to be as regular?
An update, yes.
Do we pay that then?
No, they pay that.
They pay that.
Okay. I might bring you then.
Thanks, Bill.
I'm going to move on.
Thanks, Jeff. I apologise. What I was thinking when Dave asked the question about the courts, and it was a good question, why don't we work with other agencies? We seem to be, and the department does a fantastic job, and staff are being cut and everything. But why don't we work more within between interagency with the courts? So if something happens in the courts, it automatically, when it's a taxi driver involved, it automatically lets the local council on, or dare I say even the DLV, the DVL,
DVLA.
Why can't we work with other agencies, and other agencies work with us, with local councils?
It's the job. It's
a very easy. No, but it's there to protect the public, isn't it?
Firstly, we do work with other agencies, and we've been very fortunate that the police officers, certainly within Wirral, who we have liaised with on other matters of licensing, are very supportive and have been very cooperative. As indicated, due to cuts and changes, there's been changes in the way licensing in rural has been affected in terms of police licensing. But significantly, until recently, there was what was called the notifiable occupation scheme, whereby if somebody was arrested for an offence and they gave their occupation as a taxi driver, we would be automatically notified of that. That's now gone. And we are waiting for what is going to be in its place. But we also work with the Merseyside Police and the officers who actually contribute to providing information under the Disclosure and Barring Service. And we also work with, as I say, police officers who are intelligence-led and they have intelligence on various matters. So there are processes whereby we can obtain information or information is brought to our attention, and we will always investigate that, and we will refer to the State Department in respect of how we can use that information. In terms of the courts, then I'll hand over to Mr. Abraham.
Yes, well, the courts seem to be working on that. We do get information, obviously, the taxi drivers, if they have totted up and they've got their 12 points, then they're automatically disqualified, and then they can't work from there on. So we get to know information from that end. Unlike the Licensing Act, if there is a conviction for a relevant offence, it's not incumbent upon the court to notify the local authority of that. Sometimes the local authority will not even know that the individual concerned is a taxi driver if that is not made reference to in the court case. And even then, the information is not normally imparted. It is an issue which I will raise at the court user group, which is due to sit next week. Certainly, in previous occasions, when the local authority wanted to seek confirmation of a conviction, we would ring the court up and they would provide the memorandum of conviction free charge. But as with any other department and other agency, there's now a substantial cost to that. So even if we did get clarification from the court of conviction, we would have to pay a fee of at least £60. So there are these issues. I mean, that's an example of the fact that they need to be working between parties. I seem to do that on a local level, but clearly is perhaps something which perhaps local MPs can raise at government level to ensure that, that there is ongoing agency work between the courts and the local authority.
We need that recommendations for this.
Well, it's a reason.
Okay. Right, we'll take Steve then from the move on.
Well, thank you, Chair. I was actually going to say, I think we need to understand, obviously, that this is a change from the 1 year to the 3 year. And I think, obviously, clearly, that we will be reviewing this. So, therefore, Chair, I will make the recommendation.
Okay, the recommendation set up on 13.1. So, are you going to move that?
Chair, could I just say a minor amendment, which I did read out, just for clarity, when you're referring to paragraph 13.1, that the reference to the completed medical report in accordance with the Council's policy for medicals within 28 days prior to the renewal date.
Does everybody get that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because obviously what we don't want is somebody coming along with a medical that's 4 years old.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So Councillor Edmund moved that.
Thank you.
And the Council told us. Is that agreed? Yeah.
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. Let's move forward. Move on a few more, Mrs.
Yes, thank you, Chair. This follows on from the previous item. Obviously, in changing the duration of the licence, then we need to look at the fee structure for licences that we are actually issuing, and the cost of the service that is provided in the processing of the applications. As indicated in the report, we are legally entitled to charge such a fee for the licence that we consider reasonable with a review to recovering the cost of the issue and the administration of the licence. And it just goes on to explain again about the Deregulation Act and the implications for the change in the duration of the licence. So we have reviewed the fees, and set out in the appendices of the report are the current fees in Appendix 1 and the proposed fees are set out in Appendix 2. I would obviously ensure that these fees and the costs implication of the service are kept under review, and will report back to you should there be an implication that those fees are not set at the correct level. In simple terms, with regard to the driver license, the calculation has been based on the fact that if somebody was to get a license each year, then each time they come, they get a badge with a new date on, and they also obviously have an appointment with a licensing officer. So we have taken that out of the costs for 2 years, as it were. So you've got the, if you were to multiply the annual fee three times over, then obviously it would be more than £150. So it's not a straightforward three times the current annual fee. We have worked it out on basically on the costs that we would incur. And we would still have the same costs in terms of the officer during the life of the licence, in terms of time that we may spend dealing with complaints or investigations relating to drivers. But obviously there is a reduction in the cost in terms of the badge and the appointment time for that renewal. So we've deducted that from the cost, and that's the fee that we're currently proposing. And similarly with the operator licenses, but we have looked at it and also revised the bands you will see in terms of indicating that, again, to more realistically reflect the costs of dealing with the number of vehicles attached to particular operators. And we did discuss this with the operators yesterday, and they didn't raise any concerns or objections to those proposals. Those fees will be advertised and will go out for consultation. And obviously, if there are any representations made, they will be reported to the next committee in September before implementation on the 1st of October. That's agreeable, Chair.
Thank you very much for a very comprehensive report. I take note of the multiples increase, the reason why it isn't, I think, five times or three times. If you added a bit of inflation there as well. Last question. Well, you've got two. It's going to be over the next 3 to 5 years, so I'm talking about making sure that we are well covered in that respect. And the private extra premises, it's the same figure in both squares. So, will that be an annual fee rather than the 5 years? The last part of the more comment, will we have sufficient funds to make sure that we've got inspectors to cover the changes that have come given the previous item that we've dealt with, where companies from outside of our authority would be able to monitor? I wonder if there's enough
excellent question, and I'll try and cover each of the issues raised within that question. I'll take the first one in terms of the extra premises, Mark, because I don't know if you have any view on that in terms of we set it at £50. The assumption being that would be for 5 years. Councillor just raised whether or not it should be for each year. But
I think we considered it to be adequate for an extra premises, each extra office to be charged £50 for the whole 5 years. We're looking at the number of vehicles that are operated by the operator, that's reflected in the higher fee for that. But that should be adequate. We're going to review the fees.
Yeah. I think that's the most important thing, is that we will be monitoring those fees.
Yeah.
Just explain how we are lawfully allowed to charge the fees that we charge. We haven't built in inflation as a factor here. What we are bound to do at the end of each year is to review our costs against the income that has been brought in from those fees. If there is any surplus brought in through those fees, then that has to be reflected in the next year's fees. If there is any deficit, then that can be reflected in the next year's fees. In terms of should we identify a resource issue that is a requirement in order to protect the public, and that we consider that there does need to be an increase in resources, then I would bring that back to you and ask for that to again be reflected in the fees that we charge. There are things that we can't reflect in fees, such as the prosecutions, etc. They would be borne out from any legal costs that Mr. Abraham can recover from the courts. But in terms of us monitoring compliance and ensuring that there aren't people operating illegally, and that we're satisfied that individuals are safe within vehicles and within with the drivers that we have licensed, then we certainly would want to make sure that we are fully resourced to do that and be confident that we could do that. So I will be reviewing these fees in March 2016, and should I identify any changes, I will bring that back to this committee.
Okay, councillors, to block the councillors.
Yeah, two quickies, hopefully. I'm just wondering why the 51 plus was picked, because I am aware that there are some companies on the payroll that have well over 51. And then the other one is roughly how many licences from the 1st of October we would be dealing with.